All right, hello everyone, and welcome to a new demo presentation for the Hyperledger Global Forum. Today we're going to be talking about blockchain interoperability using Cactus. My name is Enrique. I'm a tech product manager at Accenture, and I work with Cactus. The first thing to cover, something real quick, is why we are using Cactus. The first point is to address blockchain fragmentation. Blockchains, one of the objectives was to liberate information from being siloed, and now we have just different tons of different silos, blockchain networks that can't talk to each other. Cactus fixes that. We are also saving developers from reinventing the wheel, doing more complex stuff such as advanced key management on different cloud environments. ABI management in the case of Besu, for example, all of those things that are just a little bit more complicated that we usually overlook when we are building POCs, that are usually a headache when we are taking solutions to production. Cactus handles all of that. It has a plugin architecture, so basically you plug in a DAM component for your POCs, and when you want to take it to production, you just switch it for a different component that's, for example, going to manage your keys in AWS KMS. And it's literally just switching a plugin, reconfiguring your plugin, and your whole solution still works. This brings us to the last point, which is lowering the risk of adopting a specific DLT technology, specific blockchain technology. Because as we are going to see, if today you want to choose to develop your solution on top of Hyperledger Fabric, and tomorrow, for any reason, you want your solution to work on a client's network, which is on Hyperledger Besu, you can really simply just change the instance of your plugin. And if the smart contracts, if compatible smart contracts are deployed in the other network, you don't need to do any other changes to your whole stack, to your whole application. And suddenly your application works on a different DLT protocol. So we do all of this by using plugins, as we said before. We have really simple plugins, such as the keychain memory plugin that we are seeing there on the top left, which basically allows us to store data on memory. This is a typical plugin that we would use for a POC because it's just a really easy way to manage the ABIs for other smart contracts. To way more complicated plugins, such as the connectors to different DLTs. And this is an example of an instance of the plugin for the Ledger connector Besu, which allows us to interact with a Hyperledger Besu node. All of the plugins, they fit together inside of what we call a plugin registry. They can be used standalone without a problem, but by orchestrating your plugins in a specific manner, we can do really cool things that we're going to see later. Finally, just to note here an example of how a plugin can be used. Here we have declared the plugin connector Besu, and here we are using it to invoke a contract. And if you have noticed, all of these parameters are compatible with most DLT solutions, which means that if you want to change this for your Besu connector for a Hyperledger Fabric connector, you just need to change your signing credential for a signing credential that's compatible for Besu. You can parameterize this so you don't have to do that change either. You change the invocation type of your calls, and suddenly you can read your balance from the first account from a Hyperledger Fabric smart contract that has whichever name they want to put here. So the example that we're going to be seeing, it's going to be involving three different DLTs. So currently, I have in my local machine running a Hyperledger Besu, a GoQuorum, and a Hyperledger Fabric network. And they are from three different participants, which are all running their three separate networks, which are on their own network with other participants. And they want to do a traditional supply chain application. Here we can see a simple example where we are going to create register a bamboo harvest. We are then going to create a bookshelf referencing that bamboo harvest that's on a different DLT. And finally, we are going to ship that bookshelf that we are creating for the bamboo harvest. So jumping really quick to a demo, here we can see that we already created one previously, number 20. I'm just going to create a new one. Obviously, I can configure all of these parameters however we want. We'll see later how that works behind the scenes. And when I create it, here we can see it appeared B8. Now we can go to a bookshelf. We're going to create a new bookshelf, and you can see that we're going to be using the B8 that we just created, and the other one that's also available because it hasn't been consumed yet. I click on submit, and there is the new bookshelf A2. And finally, I go to the shipment to the shipper role, and there you go. And he can pick a bookshelf. I believe it was A2, the one that we just created, just to follow all the way around. And we click on submit, and this should create the shipment order for the bookshelf. So, how does all of this work? Well, it's basically we have the smart contracts behind the scenes, which are, for this example, as simple as possible, literally an insert of a specific data model for the bamboo harvest and the bookshelf. So the bookshelf has some extra parameters, such as the number of shelves, as we've seen on the demo. And then we have the connector, which is going to be used in order to interact with the node that has the smart that belongs to a network that has the smart contracts. Fortunately, with some luck, you will never have to actually see the code of the connectors themselves. You will just have to use them. And finally, we have the business logic. In this case, as we said before, we are using a plugin registry, and every component of the system is a plugin. So we have the plugin here. We're using the plugin consortium manual to manage a meta consortium, a consortium of different DLTs networks. We have the different parameters that are used to identify the different members of this meta consortium. We also have the consortium database, where we are storing different pieces of information that we want the consortium to have access to. And we also have three different clients. The clients are just connectors, as we're seeing here on the left. We have a Web3 signing credential, which is used for both the Quorum and the Hyperledger Besu nodes. And we are seeing here as well something different, which is a supply chain cactus plugin. This is literally what we call a business logic plugin. Here we've taken the business logic of this application, and we have created another plugin with it. These plugins basically are endpoints which implement the iWeb service endpoint. They can look like this. You can look at later into the example if you want to learn more about it. And in order to use them for the front end, since we have declared them as a business logic plugin, it's directly accessible from your front end. Here we can see that it literally just takes one line of code or to reference the supply chain API and to call the insert bamboo harvest endpoint, which is this one that we have defined here. And there are the parameters that we are sharing. What we're achieving here is through just one simple line of front end code, we have an application that is executing all of the logic behind the scenes that's right now managing the keys on memory. And for example, if we want to scale this, we would change the key management plugin for, let's say, the HashiCorp vault that we have, which is connected to AWS KSM. We change the smart contracts, and we don't have to touch this one either. So it allows us to build applications really, really simply and plainly, saving a lot of time for the developer if you are using all of the plugins correctly. And as you want to improve this application and scale it, you can just simply switch around the plugins. And as long as they meet the same interface, they will work, and they will allow you to create better applications, more consistent applications. This demo that we've seen specifically, it's in our repository. You can run it directly from Docker if you want to just experiment with it. And it's divided into a front-end application and a back-end application. Both of them are in our examples folder, Cactus Example Supply Chain Front-End and Cactus Example Supply Chain Business Logic Plugin. Now, if you want to try this, if you go to our repo, you will see the Docker command that you have to run. Please bear in mind that it may take some time because it has to start up three different DLTs. Before we jump to the end, I wanted to squeeze in a second part of the demo, which is going to showcase a different example, which is going to have an HTLC, an atomic swap of tokens across two different users in two operating in two different networks. And this is just to showcase as well a more direct interoperability through atomic swaps. So we've created a bunch of scripts, which will also become available for everyone to see. The key ones here are the ones that we are going to be using to create an actual HTLC. We see that we just defined the HTLC of our structure, and we have Alice and Bob. Alice is going to create a contract to exchange 10 of her tokens in her network for one Ether in Bob's blockchain network. And Bob's is going to create the same thing. As you can see, it is as simple as just basically defining a new contract request with the parameters that you want to exchange, and then just declaring that new contract once you have instantiated the plugin for the the HTLC plugin. The HTLC plugin in this case is just it just needs the parameters to implement the iPlugin HTLC Besu ERC20 in this case, because this is an ERC20. And for Bob's case, it's just directly ETH, what we are exchanging. Now, let us jump directly to see the code. I'm initiating and deploying all of the required contracts, because we are using two Ganache networks. This one is for Alice and this one is for Bob. And right now we can, for example, get the balance for Alice, and we can see that Alice in her network has 100 tokens. And if we run the same command for Bob, please excuse the slowness on the execution. It has to do with the fact that we're using NPX and TypeScript directly for the demo. The actual execution is blazing fast. It's what comes after when appears this one here. And we can see that Bob has 0 tokens here.
Okay, there are 2 questions in the Q&A window. I don't know if you saw those.
Nope. Let's leave them for the end.
Well, that's just about now.
Okay. Then really quickly, I'm gonna execute the remaining commands to deploy the contracts. And then to actually reclaim the tokens on the other side. And in the meantime, let's see the questions. All right. So the first one is, the demo contains quite a few components, which ones are shipped with Cactus and which ones are custom business components. So basically everything is that we have seen is within Cactus repository. The part that will have to be made new for a new application will be just the business logic plugin, which is not a requirement. You can use the existing plugins as a standalone things. So for example, you can just have you can just use directly a Hyperledger Fabric connector using the keychain memory plugin inside of your application, just like you would use the regular SDK. The regular Fabric Node SDK. And the second question is, could you show the structure of the application? Where are the plugins and endpoints defined in Ethereum smart contracts or in Fabric chain code? So yes, we can do that. The endpoints are defined on the, so everything, as we said before, is part of a Cactus, and there are Cactus plugins. The endpoints is what the business logic plugin is. It's just basically where the endpoints are defined. And in this case, let me just find here. This is what the business logic plugin looks like. This is the actual core of it. And here is where the different interfaces for the different endpoints are defined. Since we don't have time, I would encourage everyone to either go directly to a Rocket Chat, or we have a daily call at 5:30 GMT, where you can actually, it's an open call inside of Hyperledger's calendar, where you can join the developers and we do pair programming sessions. So if you, the best way to actually to get started, besides just running our examples and trying to go through our code, is to join one of those sessions. Join one of those sessions and we'll help you get started with your first project. We'll help you go through this to go through the specific demo, build it on your own environment, and you can play around with it. You can change things, and that's usually the best way to experiment it. We're still iterating in our documentation, but we do have as well a read the docs. And I don't believe there were any other questions. And just to finish this really quickly, I don't know if I did that correctly. Yes. So we finished executing everything. So now if we check out Alice's balance, she's going to have 10 less tokens and a little bit more Ether. There you go. She used to have 100. And if we do the same thing for Bob, he's going to have now 10 tokens. And what we've seen here is an atomic swap across two different DLTs. This means that, well, we all know what an atomic swap is. We all know more or less how HTLCs work. And if you don't, I encourage you again to just jump into the Rocket Chat and ask the questions, and we can maybe provide some guidance. And I believe that's, I'm already a minute over time.
Yep.
We're done with the questions.
Yeah, we have other events starting. So thank you very much. It was an excellent presentation.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Have a nice one. Bye-bye.